Welcome to our service. We're so thankful that you've been able to join with us as we worship God together. And we begin with some words from Psalm 105. Give thanks to the Lord, call upon his name, make known his deeds among the peoples, sing to him, sing praises to him, tell of all his wondrous works, glory in his holy name. Let the hearts of those who seek the Lord rejoice. Seek the Lord and his strength. Seek his presence continually. Let us pray. Father, we thank you that we are able to worship you, to join together to worship you. We're able to call upon your name. And Father, we pray that you'd help us to make known your deeds among the people. Help us to tell of all your wondrous works. Help us to glory in your name. And Lord, we pray that we would know your strength, your support, your encouragement, your guidance. And Lord, even as we come together this day, we ask that by your Spirit you would minister into each one of our lives. We're so thankful for this amazing weather that there has been, and we pray that it will continue. We pray that we will be refreshed and renewed, that we'll be encouraged. We pray for protection, for safety, for well-being. But Lord, we pray for a fresh experience of you, a fresh touch of your Spirit that renews us and restores us. In Jesus' name we pray. Amen. And we sing, And Can It Be?
And can it be that I should gain an interest in the Savior's blood? Died he for me, who caused his pain, for me who him to death pursued? Amazing love, how can it be that thou, my God, choose to die for me? Amazing love, how can it be that thou, my God, choose to die for me? He left his father's throne above.
as we were singing, we were proclaiming and celebrating God's amazing love, His grace, His mercy, the assurance and hope that can be ours through faith in Christ. And as we worship together, let's join in confessing our sins to God, asking for His forgiveness and His help to respond to His love and to live more faithfully for Him. And so we say, Heavenly Father, we have sinned against You and against our neighbour, in thought and word and deed, through negligence, through weakness, through our own deliberate fault, by what we have done and by what we have failed to do. We are truly sorry and repent of all our sins. For the sake of Your Son, Jesus Christ, who died for us, forgive us all that is past, and grant that we may serve You in newness of life, to the glory of Your name. Amen. May Almighty God, who forgives all who truly repent, have mercy on us, pardon and deliver us from all our sins, confirm and strengthen us in all goodness, and keep us in eternal life through Jesus Christ our Lord. Amen. And then the collect, the special prayer for this Sunday, the seventh Sunday after Trinity. Lord of all power and might, the author and giver of all good things, graft in our hearts the love of Your name. Increase in us true religion. Nourish us with all goodness. And of Your great mercy, keep us in the same, through Jesus Christ our Lord. Amen. Now Rory's going to read from Ephesians 2.
The second chapter of the letter to the Ephesians, beginning at the 11th verse. Therefore, remember that formerly you, who are Gentiles by birth, and called uncircumcised by those who call themselves the circumcision, that done in the body by the hands of men. Remember that at that time you were separate from Christ, excluded from citizenship in Israel, and foreigners to the covenants of the promise, without hope and without God in the world. But now in Christ Jesus, you who once were far away have been brought near through the blood of Christ. For He Himself is our peace, who has made the two one and has destroyed the barrier, the dividing wall of hostility, by abolishing in His flesh the law with its commandments and regulations. His purpose was to create in Himself one new man out of the two, thus making peace, and in this one body to reconcile both of them to God through the cross, by which He put to death their hostility. He came and preached peace to you who were far away, and peace to those who were near. For through Him we both have access to the Father by one Spirit. Consequently, you are no longer foreigners and aliens, but fellow citizens with God's people and members of God's household, built on the foundation of the apostles and prophets, with Christ Jesus Himself as the chief cornerstone. In Him, the whole building is joined together and rises to become a holy temple in the Lord. And in Him, you too are being built together to become a dwelling in which God lives by His Spirit. This is the word of the Lord.
Let us pray. Heavenly Father, we thank You for this day and that we're able to gather. Lord, we thank You for Your word, which is a light to our feet and a joy in our lives. And so we pray that we would know You more dearly, see You more clearly, and see the good works that You are calling us to in Christ this day, those things that You have prepared for us. Be with us now, Lord, we pray. Amen. There is something about the summer weather that seems to bring out all types of people. Recently, I was up in Belfast and I was walking around Queen's and Botanic Gardens, a wonderful part of the city. And within the space of almost a square mile, you tend to see every expression of what it means to be human. Students seeking to find themselves, adults seeking to express themselves in new ways and bold ways. If you're a people watcher, it's the perfect place as you mingle across and through the streets, through the park, and see every different expression of identity. Locals enjoying the sun on the grass, making clear by their accent. International students or people here to work and enjoying the rare bliss of Northern Irish sunshine. Senior citizens exploring the city. Every person expressing themselves in different ways, hairstyles, outfit choices, even by the mode of transport or the clothes that we wear. We express who we are and who we think we are to the world, and sometimes we don't even realize it. The things that we base ourselves on define how we dress, how we style, and how we present. There in that area of Belfast, you've so many different expressions of identity, people portraying themselves to the world. And I think that's true of any city space, any university space. And today, we tend to sum up those expressions under that word, identity. If you Google it, you'll find any manner of books, blog, or inspirational quotes about this human quest for purpose, for meaning. And I think often we think these things are new struggles, new roads to travel. And yet every culture, every context, every place has asked these questions, wrestled with what it means to be human, to be true to what we are. In Paul's letter today, we are with him as he writes to the church in Ephesus, a small group of new disciples seeking to understand what it means to know Jesus, to live for him, and to be defined through him in a city and in a culture that was a melting pot of chaos as people fought to be known and to know. Ephesus, a city where cultural expression clashed as different points of the empire met in one place. Classes from which the church wasn't exempt, wasn't immune. And in that battered culture, that battered place of identity and expression, Paul seeks to encourage the church to know Christ and to be rooted in Christ Jesus. There's no real specific reason, seemingly, for Paul writing to Ephesus. He's not addressing a specific issue, nor was he seeking to encourage them as they faced a specific challenge. The letter to Ephesus, the Ephesians, lays out general gospel truths and principles to live for, based on who Jesus is and what he has done. Instructions for every believer, and a call to be rooted and identified in Jesus this day. It's a city obsessed with magic and mystery. We think of Acts 19, verse 19. And Paul here emphasizes throughout this letter the power of God over all the things in earth and in heaven, and Christ's authority as head of the church, and his authority both now and in the age to come. Paul paints a picture that calls this church and us as believers in the body of Christ to trust God regardless of the challenges we face, the battles we are going through, because God is supreme over all things. In chapter 1, as we thought about last week, we were reminded about the spiritual blessings that are ours in Christ and through Christ, not because of what we've done, but by faith. Over and over again, Paul reminds this church of what Jesus has done for them. And you were included in Christ when you heard the message of truth, the gospel of your salvation, he wrote. Then Paul went on to outlay with thanksgiving his heart's desire for this church. He was pleased with how they lived for Jesus and how they sought to live for him. He rejoiced in their faith and what the Lord was doing for them. And he prayed that they would know the Lord more. Verse 17 of chapter 1. And then Paul flows into that great prayer and proclamation of the power of Jesus, the beauty and power of grace at work in the life of the believer. And after praying that they might know more of God, he reminds them that that same power that raised Jesus from the dead is at work in them as individuals and as a church, and nothing will overcome it. Then, just before our passage today, Paul begins to unload the wonder of grace. the grace that is at work at them. Firstly, reminding them of their previous reality. They were lost in their sins, wandering in death like the rest of the world, spinning on this hamster wheel and getting nowhere. But because of God, who being rich in mercy, because of his great love, made us alive together with Christ. Verses 4 and 5 of chapter 2. And how does that new life come to the believer? But by grace that we have been saved. Everyone wants to know value in life, to belong to something. We struggle and strive for it in the world. Paul reminds us, church, that it's not through our efforts that it comes, but through grace. Grace that is powerful and at work in us and through us for the glory of God. The Christian finds life not in any single purpose or identity or pursuit, but through faith in Christ. Verse 8 of chapter 2. Through the work of Jesus on the cross, we were reconciled to God, and this new life is a gift of God through grace, and with it comes a new purpose. The good works of God that he's called each of us to and set out before the foundations of time for each of us. Hence, the wonderful words just before our passage today, for we are God's handiwork, created in Christ Jesus to do good works, which God prepared in advance for us to do. And while the works of the world can never produce salvation for humankind, contrasted here, the works of God in the disciples produces good fruits, good works. We are each unique, created by God for a purpose known by God, and we are called to that purpose. Thus, as Paul begins this wonderful passage of peace, we're reminded of grace as he writes, therefore, it's that from this grace, the peace of God flows into us and between us if we're disciples of Jesus. The peace-filled passage here flows wonderfully from the grace-filled preceding explanation. It's almost an expansion of Paul's introduction to the letter. Grace and peace to you from our Father and the Lord Jesus Christ. And while the peace of Christ is made known through all of creation, here Paul seems to focus in on the inclusion of the Gentiles, those who were outside the Jewish faith, in to the family of God. Not by any ethnic definition or human identity, but by faith through grace. Specifically, no longer would any human facet play a relation apart with how we relate to God, but how we respond in faith to what Christ has done. God set out to gather all things to himself under heaven and earth in Jesus. But central to that plan was the gathering of all the people into a new humanity defined by Jesus, defined by grace. Hence, Paul reminds those in Ephesus here, whether they were Gentiles by birth, that once they were far from God, now in Christ, they are near. They are included. Once they were the uncircumcised in a disparaging way, now through faith, they have the wonder of fullness and relationship with God. The work of Jesus on the cross here removes every barrier for us to know God and to be known by God and to make God known as he works in us. It frees us to live for him. In verses 14 to 18, we see that from this peace comes a new humanity, that in Christ there's no identity that age in our coming to God, no bloodline, no family history. All that matters is how we respond to him. That's what Paul means here in verse 14 as he writes, he is our peace. It's Jesus in whom we trust. Christ has made us all, regardless of where we come from, our tribal backgrounds, our political beliefs, one in God. Specifically here in the Church of Ephesus, it was that division between the Jews and the Gentiles. But what matters as this outworks today is that we come in faith through grace, not that we come trusting in our own struggles, our own identities, our own faith backgrounds. through his death, Jesus abolished the law and that divided the Jewish people from the Gentile world and created a new humanity at peace with God and at peace with one another. All people are united in his body, the church, through the cross to God and to each other. The cross of Christ puts to death our hostilities to God and actually sometimes our hostilities between one another. We don't define people by how they fit into our boxes in the church. We define them and know them by how they respond in faith to what God has done through Christ. Thus, from that new humanity, known only by the blood of Jesus, identified only in him, and by living for him, comes a new temple of God, as the people of God are reconciled to him, to live for him, and to make him known. In the final section here, verses 19 to 22, Paul resumes his address to the Gentiles as he outworks that peace through grace in their lives. Specifically, the Gentiles in the Ephesian church, reminding them that they were once foreigners or resident aliens among God's people, but they are no longer that. They are citizens of a household of God. He expresses this radical inclusion with a wonderful image, that of the holy temple of God. Holiness characterizing all the saints who were set apart to do the works of God and for relationship with God, verse 19. If we are in Christ, then we belong to the household of God. And we belong to the household of God as a temple of God, as God dwells in us to make himself known in the world. We grow into this holy temple as the grace of God and the power of God and the dwelling of God in the Holy Spirit transforms us into the image of Christ. We express our purpose in how we live in the world. We are built up upon the foundations of the apostles and the prophets, and Christ is the cornerstone. He is our identity and our purpose. All of this talk of Jewish and Gentile struggles can seem so far off from our world today, as we're some 2,000 years later in a different context, and yet actually often our identity is known not just by simply who we think we are, but who we define ourselves against. Today, we often struggle with this in terms of politics and so many other things, but yet here we're reminded that in the church, what matters above all else is where we stand in relation to Jesus. Have we responded to the grace of God? Do we know him by faith? Because all other things are secondary. And then if that is true for us, or we think it to be true, is that the defining purpose of our lives? Do we define ourselves first as Christian, willing to set aside all other things for that cause and for that beautiful relationship with God? Or do we still find ourselves trusting in created things? From this grace comes good works, that we were saved for a purpose, verse 10 just before. And one of those good works is peace. Jesus said to the disciples that by this you will know, everyone will know if you are my disciple, if you love one another. John 13, verse 35. And part of our loving of one another is being reconciled to one another, dealing with our issues and our struggles, to display our love of God to the world. Thus, if we are God's household, then we define people not by politics, by tribal, by ethnicity, social status, but through Christ. So today, as we think of this wonderful passage of peace and what it means to know God, let's make sure our first and primary identity is rooted in Jesus and what he has done for us on the cross. Let us respond to the grace of God. And as that grace becomes real in us, then, and we make it known in the world by doing that which God has called us to, let us be a people who pursue with one another that peace of God to display to the world, so often at war with itself, a better way, a better identity, and a greater hope, so that they too can know the wonder of life with Christ. What matters not in the church is not our styles or preferences or our desires, but where we stand in Christ. So today, let us stand firm on the cornerstone and live for him. Let us pray. Heavenly Father, we give you thanks for this day and that we are saved not by our struggles, not by our works, not by our understanding of self, but by what Christ has done for us and how we respond to that in faith. And so, Lord, we pray that we are first known and know ourselves in Jesus. And we pray, Lord, that as that truth takes root in our heart, it becomes real in our lives and how we relate to one another as we seek to be a people of peace, that from the grace of God received flows the peace of God in our lives as the Spirit of God works in us to make us into your holy temple, set apart to know you, to love you, and to make you known. Be with us, Lord, this week. Send us out in your peace to love one another, to love you, and to make you known by how we live in this world. Amen.
Thank you. Let us pray. Almighty God, we give you thanks and praise that when we were still far off, you reconciled us to yourself in Christ. By your Spirit, you enable us to live as your sons and daughters. Help us, Holy Spirit, to know our need of grace, to walk in the way of the cross and communicate the hope of Christ and share in his ministry of love and service to one another in these days, we pray. Amen. Creator of all that is seen and unseen, help us to protect and preserve the world you created. Give us courage to support the work against all environmental issues that we face. Teach us to be responsible stewards of this world and to seek the common good, that through your blessing, all may flourish. Help us to build communities of faith and joy where all are welcomed into the hope of your unending love, we pray. Amen. We pray for the parts of our world where violence and strife continues to ravage society. We pray for the protection and well-being of all your people. We are mindful of Yemen at this time, a country that faces huge humanitarian crisis. The devastating effects of conflict has destroyed many hospitals and healthcare centers, left people in urgent need of food, safe water, sanitation, and medical supplies. We pray that you know the physical and spiritual need of your people. And God, where there is division and barriers, we pray for breakthrough. Where resources and supplies lack, God, we ask that you would provide. We pray for all those who work to maintain order, for those who work in rescue and relief efforts, and all those who continue to live in the midst of conflict. Defend them and protect them. Make known to them your peace and grant them strength and courage for the days ahead, we pray. Amen. We pray for our children and young people. We give thanks for their energy, joy, and laughter. Help us to love them, protect them, guide them, and to teach them to what it means to follow you. May they discover their unique talents and giftings and find ways to serve you. As a church, we pray that we would raise up a generation of leaders, that we would be disciples making disciples. And we pray that you would mold and shape us, empower and equip us to be everything you have called us to be. We pray. Amen. As we belong to the family of God, we pray for our own families and friends who we call family. We thank you for the support and security they bring. Pour out your blessing on them. We pray for those relationships where there is division, that you would bring reconciliation and unity. Soften the hardness of our hearts. And we pray for those who have felt or been abandoned, that you would draw them close and reveal your faithfulness to them. We pray that in all our relationships, we would demonstrate love, mercy, peace, and kindness, that you would nurture and support one another. We pray for those known to us who have not come to know and experience your redeeming love. Lord, we pray that you would be at work in their story, that they would find Jesus in the midst of the trials of life, we pray. Amen. We pray for the physical, mental, and spiritual health of all your people. We pray for those who are struggling with the pressures of life, for those who are anxious, for those who are weary, for those who mourn, and for those who are sick or suffering in any way. In a moment of silence, we lift to the Lord those on our hearts at this time. We pray, God, that you would draw near to them and their loved ones now, that in this season they would rest in the comfort of Christ. We pray for healing and wholeness. Grant them strength and courage for the days that lie ahead, and through the power they would know your presence and peace, we pray. Amen. Father, we ask all these things, trusting in the same Lord Jesus, who in the unity of the Holy Spirit is one with you, now and forever. And we join our prayers together in the words Jesus taught us to pray. Our Father, who art in heaven, hallowed be thy name. Thy kingdom come, thy will be done on earth as it is in heaven. Give us this day our daily bread, and forgive us our trespasses, as we forgive those who trespass against us. And lead us not into temptation, but deliver us from evil. For thine is the kingdom, the power, and the glory, forever and ever. Amen.
And the blessing. May the peace of God, which passes all understanding, keep our hearts and minds in the knowledge and love of God, and of his Son, Jesus Christ our Lord. And the blessing of God Almighty, the Father, the Son, and the Holy Spirit be with you and remain with you this day and forevermore. Amen. then in terms of announcements, our in-person services continue each Sunday at 10 here in Holy Trinity, in St. Patrick's Church at 10, in St. Patrick's Church Hall at 10, there's the all-age service, and then the service in Holy Trinity Church Hall at 11:15. Our online services go out online each Sunday at 10:30, and our kids program goes out at 11:30 online. And this Sunday marks the beginning of our online holiday Bible club, which will be available on each of the following Sundays for the next 5 weeks. In terms of other services, on Wednesday, we have our service here in the church, our service of morning prayer here in Holy Trinity. On Wednesday as well, we have toddler time, and please check out about that on the Facebook or on the website. And please do register for that. Please do spread word about that and encourage people to come and be part of that. Next Sunday, we have our parish picnic at 12 o'clock out in the grounds of the church here. I really want to encourage you to come along to that. We'll be following the guidelines in terms of that are existing at this present time. But please bring with you everything that you need in terms of food, something to sit on, whether that's a deck chair or a rug, whatever it might be. But we would really love to see you, and just that we have that chance to interact with one another. On Saturday morning, Baby Plus continues. Please do spread the word about that, just reminding folk that that's on each Saturday morning from 10 to 12, where we have pre-loved new clothes for babies and toddlers, and we want to provide that just to folk in the community who can benefit from it. Thank you for joining with us today, and may the Lord bless you and keep you until we meet again.